take a moment today to thank the boldness of our government and our shareholders.
William Hamilton built his venture on the ashes of the Second World War. Copper mine he envisioned was ransacking the First Nation's ancestral territories, drawing the wrath of the local people. It definitely took nerves of steel to stay the course, despite all this hostility. Before long, in the face of William Hamilton's cold and uncompromising stance, the petitions and peaceful protests turned into sabotage, vandalism, and other criminal acts. The industrialists' private properties also encountered the wrath of the demonstrations. Carl Faubert, a veteran of the Korean War, was hired from Montreal as a private detective to shed some light on this whole thing. But at the end of his long journey to northern Quebec, the detective did not only encounter property damage, he also came face to face with the corpse of William Hamilton. The strangeness only kept building throughout the investigation. A powerful, unseasonable blizzard hit the region. Bodies frozen in unbreakable ice appeared. The local fauna began to act strangely and aggressively. Carl Faubert began to doubt his own sanity. The detective felt the weight of a gaze as if he were at the mercy of a powerful, feral creature waiting for the right moment to attack. Carl's fear was taking over, overpowering his reason. He was giving in to delirium. In that instant, he thought that the dark waters of the lake might shield him from the shapes that pursued him. From there, he had a renewed hope in civilization, or whatever was left of it. Carl knew that on one of these shores stood William Hamilton's lavish mansion, and there the detective had hopes of finding a way out of the area. A phone, a truck, who knows? Under the luxurious paneling and damask carpets, he might be able to find answers to his questions. The detective wondered about the floating debris. Had it drifted out from the shore, or had it been abandoned there in the middle of nowhere? Carl saw a boat in the distance, clearly piloted by one of his own. Had he finally made it to civilization? His hopes were immediately drowned out by the sound of gunshots. Time to flee again, and fast. Swam without a thought, yet each stroke was desperate. The icy water and his wounds made him feel weaker and weaker. He had to get to shore. The hypothermia were tearing at Carl's poor body. When he finally saw a light in the distance, he was filled with a faint sense of hope. Could it be a refuge? Carl was convinced that he would not wake up if he went to sleep in this state. It was probably best to make a fire and take a look at his wounds. Carl struggled to wake up. His makeshift bandages offered him little time. If he wanted to find the truth, he had to get to Hamilton Manor without delay. Just as he was about to venture outside, Carl suddenly felt vulnerable. He had not brought anything to protect himself. Just as he was about to venture outside, Carl suddenly felt vulnerable. He had not brought anything to protect himself. Carl was forgetting that time was running out. He had to go to the manor if he wanted to find the answers to his questions. Carl Faubert was a sensible man. Attacking that wolf would not be among his smartest life choices. The ice looked recent. Better not test it. Tried to put the horror into perspective. Accidents happen, and in the inhospitable far north, it happens more often than not. Nevertheless, a feeling of déjà vu stayed with him, as if the carnage was not over. The plan suggested that a package had to be retrieved not far away. Carl had to keep his eyes open. An access card, a rather modern piece of technology, especially for a mining complex in the far north. What could it possibly open? What were these mysterious fragments? And why was there a warning about the broom? This letter raised more questions than it answered for the detective. This was the mansion of the late William Hamilton. No doubt about it. There was no other rich industrialist in the area to have a sumptuous mansion built in the middle of nowhere.
Si vous entendez ceci, ce message est crucial. Trouvez un endroit où vous mettre à l'abri. Ne sortez qu'en dernier recours. Si vous avez à sortir, armez-vous et méfiez-vous de quiconque porte les couleurs de la Hamilton Mining Corporation. Tenez-vous le plus loin possible de la faune. Les animaux sont devenus extrêmement agressifs. Je répète, tenez-vous le plus loin possible des animaux et méfiez-vous de quiconque porte les couleurs de la HMC. Si vous entendez ceci, ce message est crucial. Trouvez un endroit où vous mettre à l'abri. Ne sortez qu'en dernier recours. Si vous avez à sortir, armez-vous et méfiez-vous de quiconque porte les couleurs de la Hamilton Mining Corporation. Tenez-vous le plus loin possible de la faune. Les animaux sont devenus extrêmement agressifs. Je répète, tenez-vous le plus loin possible des animaux et méfiez-vous de quiconque porte les couleurs de la HMC.
Added to the mayhem was violence. Carl understood that a tragedy had occurred here. Feel his muscles weakening, his breath wheezing, his body going numb. What was happening to him? Rocking. The walls seemed to be running from Carl's hands as he tried to steady himself. Something was not right. Carl's thoughts were twisting in his head, making him dizzy. Carl knew how eccentric older millionaires could be, with more money than they know how to spend it. But never could he have imagined such a sophisticated puzzle. Carl Faubert made a profession out of reconstructing a hole from seemingly incongruous parts. This reconstructed globe forced him to recognize how much more complex the mystery that was currently plaguing Manistan was in comparison. feet could hardly find their way in front of him. He doesn't know which way he came from or the way he's going. Everything seems to be going in a circle. Suddenly feels like he's waking up, but inside the dream. The cold hits him suddenly, like a bucket of freezing water. Had he completely lost it? Or was he supposed to accept the manor's strange architecture, suddenly leading him to the middle of nowhere? These imposing structures seem to come from the depths of time, or from the moon landing, or even from his own mind, clouded after an afternoon nap. The detective had no idea how it worked, but the stones seemed to slide on the rails smoothly as soon as the totem pole was rotated. did not know how or why, but Carl sensed that something in this game had been completed. And now they wanted to lead him to this cabin. By a larger force towards the light that was calling him, as if it was asking to be set free. The stone that resonated in the room must have been one of the fragments HMC had been seeking. If he isolated it, Carl hoped he might come to his senses. The pulse of the stone invaded Carl's mind, and he felt a strange, dark presence take shape near him. Carl could make out some trophies here and there that he had seen earlier in what seemed like a dream. Made it impossible to get to the staircase. There had to be another way. The whistle slowly dying down like a kettle going out meant only one thing for Carl. Mission accomplished. The shape of a wolf, but Carl Faubert knew instinctively that it was not the wolf. That gaze that never left him, that icy blue gaze, was not that of an animal. Man is wolf to man, said the philosopher. Seeing the state of this poor woman, one could only imagine such fury, which would explain the barricades and the fright that Carl could sense in the chaos of the place. What had happened here was not caused by a man. As he approached this room, Carl again felt an unpleasant sensation of energy, as if his entire being was bubbling on a molecular level. Sound of it, whatever had just fallen was monumental in size. Carl Faubert was on edge. In this boudoir's former glory, you would have seen Lady Hamilton's refinement in every inch of the tapestry. It had become only a shadow of what it once was. Looking at these posters, Faubert took the measure of what Rachel Hamilton had to give up to follow her husband in these barren lands. Hamilton's room would keep its secrets. A disaster made it impossible to enter.
Just a few days of renovation work and you'll finally have your very own projection room, my dear. Aren't you going to say anything?
There's nothing to say.
Whatever do you mean?
That room, it's not for me. Nothing has ever been.
Come now, don't speak nonsense. You know I love you.
As much as you love Cynthia? I know about her, William, and I'm too wary to care. About anything.
You're off your rocker. There is no Cynthia.
Never mind. It doesn't matter.
This wolf had a strange appearance, larger than average, and these blue eyes, that icy stare. Carl felt an instinctive terror rise in him. was always harder when you could put a name to them. Carl deduced that this poor man must be Charles, Hamilton's servant. Whatever had forced its way through this wall was beyond the wrath of one man or group. Evil had entered through it. An impossible creature had taken over the manor. Hamilton left everything to Henry. From his knowledge of their family history, Faubert had rather expected Hamilton to disown him. Despite everything, perhaps the father could never stop loving his son. Faubert smirked as he spotted his phone number on the list. If only someone else had taken the job before him, he would still be in Montreal, sitting warm and comfortable in his car, taking pictures of some unfaithful spouse. Put his memories in order, but there was a more pressing issue. The decaying mansion had collapsed on top of him, trapping him in the basement. No need to try. Carl would not be able to go through there.